Hello everyone, Testing eLearn welcomes you to the day 5 of the manual testing course. Today our topic is black box testing. We are going to talk about introduction to black box testing, types of black box testing, and each and every type is further divided into subtypes. We'll be doing each and everything in very detail today. I will give you plenty of examples, plenty of real-time scenarios, and a lot of applications I'm going to show you today to make you clear the concept of black box testing. Okay, black box testing is a very, very important concept. It's very important from the interview point of view and very interesting too. And I hope everyone is going to enjoy today's session. Okay, let's start up now. Let me open up Notepad. Okay. Black box testing. Black box testing is the name itself is telling me that it is a type of testing where the box is closed. Box here means application, where the application is closed. We are not going inside the application. Here, we are not concerned at all with which programming language developer is using, which logic developer is using, how he is converting the input into output. We are not bothered at all. Here, we are going to test the application as a user. How we are going to test the application as a user? By giving different sets of data. By giving plenty of test data, by passing plenty of test data, we are going to test our application and we are going to check how our application is behaving, what output we are getting. Then, we are going to verify our output with the SRS if our output which we are getting is as per our expectation, is actually what we are expecting. Is as per the SRS, that is software requirement specification. We have already discussed about this document in the previous session. And we are checking if the output is exactly with what we wanted, then it's fine. Otherwise, it means there is something wrong in the application. There is something wrong in the logic. Something is buggy in the application. Then you have to make an Excel sheet and you have to report it to the developer. It's your duty if the output you are getting, that is the actual output, is not equal to the expected output, then you have to report it as a bug to the developer. So simply in black box testing, tester gets involved. Here, tester gets involved. Another name for black box testing could be closed box testing. Simply, the box is closed. The application is closed. We are not going inside the box. We are just simply the application as a user. Suppose, let me give you one example here. If we talk about gmail.com. Let me show you. This is gmail.com on my screen. In gmail.com, if I am given a task that I have to verify the login functionality of the Gmail, what I will do? I will try to enter some valid username and I will enter some valid password and I keep on signing. If I am able to log in into the application, it means it's working fine. Second thing what I can do is, I can enter some invalid username and invalid password and I click on sign in. Then I should not be able to log in into the application. I should not be able to log in into the application. What else? Along with that, I should get some user-friendly error message on the screen. Something like, please enter valid username or password. Or the username or the password you have entered is invalid. Some user-friendly error message I should get. So that the user can rectify his error. Whatever he has entered, he should get to know that what mistake he is doing up. Which kind of data is not valid, which he is entering. So it is a closed box testing. Not we are not going inside the box. Second name for black box testing could be functionality testing. Functionality testing, name itself is telling we are testing the functionality of the application. The same example here could be, that is gmail.com, entering username password, valid username password, I should be able to log in into the application. On entering invalid username or password, I should not be able to enter into the application. I should not be able to log in. That is, we are checking here the functionality of the application simply as a user. Simply as a user we are testing. Last name could be behavioral testing. Behavioral testing. That is, here on entering different sets of data, I am checking how my application is behaving. How my application is behaving on entering different sets of data, on passing different sets of input values, how my application is behaving. That's what we are checking here in black box testing. That's why we can call it behavioral testing. So, the definition is clear here. See, in our course, we will not be focusing on the bookish definition. We will try to clear our concept by giving different examples. Even in the interview, try to give different real-time scenarios instead of giving a bookish, a cramped definition here. So, now we are going to move towards the types of black box. Types of black box testing. Black box testing is broadly divided into four types. One is usability testing. Second is functionality testing. Third is security testing. And the last one is performance testing. Performance. Usability testing. Name itself is telling me that it is a type of testing where I am concerned with the user interface of the application. How much attractive my user interface is. How much good my user interface is. How much user friendly my interface is. This is what I am looking for in usability testing. That is, I am checking the look of my application. How my application is looking. These days, what is the main purpose of website? What is the main purpose of a website? We always want more and more people to visit our website. Even every business wants more and more people to visit their application. More and more people to visit their website. And what else we want? The people who are visiting our website should revisit our website again. Should revisit our website again and again. We want them to revisit. This is possible only if we have user-friendly interface. This is possible if we have a very attractive interface. Means the people who are visiting, they should not find our application complicated at all. They should not find our application difficult at all. It should not be like that a people who is a domain expert, who has the knowledge of that domain, is able to view my application, is able to assess my application. No. Even a person who is totally new to that domain should find my application very interesting, very easy to use, very easy to navigate. Means whatever the client or the visitor is looking for in my application, it should get that in a click. In a click, the user should get what the information he is looking for in my application. So, very easy and attractive user interface my application is need to have. Usability testing itself is having two types, divided into two categories. That is, first is user interface testing. Another one is manual support testing. Manual support testing. User interface testing. Clear from the name, we are looking for good user interface. We are looking for attractive user interface. Here we are going to focus on three things. We are going to focus on three things that are, first is easy to use, second is look and feel, third is quick interface. Let's talk about these three points in very detail. Easy to use. My application should be very easy to use. Even illiterate people should be able to assess my application. A person who has zero knowledge in the domain, zero domain knowledge, again, he should be able to assess my application very easily. So, here, how I am going to test my application for easy to use? How I get to know that whether my application is really easy to use or not? How I can find it out? Being a tester, I should know some rules to check whether if my application is following these rules, it means my application easy to use. How I am going to test it? So for this, Microsoft has given us 6 rules They are known as Microsoft 6 rules. If my application is obeying those 6 rules, if my application is following those 6 rules, it means my application is easy to use. It means my application is easy to use. So here, in easy to use, we are going to talk about Microsoft 6 rules. Microsoft 6 rules to check whether my application is obeying these 6 rules or not. That is, first is, control should be well defined. Control should be well defined. Let me explain this point. See, here, this is gmail.com on my screen. Everything on this page is a control. This is an image, this is a control. This text is a control. This sign-in text is a control. This username text is a control. This edit box where we enter username is a control. Password is a control. Edit box for password, still a control. The sign-in button, this is a, everything on the page is a control. Control should be well-defined, means every control on the page, the purpose of that control should be very clear to me. Just by looking at the control, I should know the purpose. The edit box with, placed in front of username. It is telling me why this edit box is placed. This is placed for me to enter a valid username. Why the edit box placed in front of password? To enter a valid password. Why the sign in button is placed? That is, after entering valid username and password, click on this sign. Just by looking at the application, I am getting the purpose of the various controls placed on the application. That's what we want, that the purpose of every control should be clear to us. Second is, control should not be wrapped, truncated or overlapped. Should not be wrapped, truncated or overlapped. What does this mean? That suppose in this gmail.com, sign is written inside the button, in is written outside the button. Let us say, it will not look pleasing to the eye. It will not be very visible to the user. It will not look attractive to the user. That's what we want. That every control should be very clear. It should not be wrapped, truncated or overlapped. Third is, control should provide a complete description. Control should provide complete description. What does this mean? Control should provide complete description. It means, suppose in a page, I get the total is 1000. What is this 1000? Is it rupees? Is it USD? Is it liters? Is it meters? Is it kilometers? What it is? Means every control should provide me a complete description. That is, it should not provide me any kind of vague information. The control should give me a full and complete information. After this comes init cap. Init cap means that the first alphabet of every word has to be capital. Let us say, look at my notepad window. Here, file, F is capital. Edit, E is capital. Format, F is capital. View, V is capital. H is capital. If we click here on format, word wrap, W is capital, wrap, W is capital, font, S is, a first letter of every word has to be capital. This word Microsoft says. It's the meaning of init cap. Fifth, spell checking. In our application, there should not be any spelling mistakes. Suppose if you visit any website and you see there are plenty of spelling mistakes, what will happen? Either you will close the application or you may not visit the application again. Because it gives a very bad impact on the visitor or the person viewing the website. That is, so always check for spelling mistakes, that in your application there should not be any spelling mistakes. And the last is, after spelling mistakes, let's talk about system manual. This is the last rule of the Microsoft system. What is system manual? Suppose here I go at the top of my notepad. I make a right click. It is giving me some menu. I right click here. It is giving me some menu. The system menu. If I want to do copy paste, either I can go here on the edit, I click and I can do the copy paste operation, or simply I can right click and I can make these operations. This means Microsoft says to do one thing, we should have plenty of options available. To do one thing, it should not be like only one way is available. We should have one or two different ways to do the same thing. So that a user, if the user is not aware of the one way, he can use some other alternative to do the task. Suppose if I want to save my this notepad file, what I can use, I can either press Ctrl plus S, or I can go here to the file menu and I can save my. Just to do one thing, there should be different options available. So this is system menu. After this, we'll talk about look and see. We'll talk about look and see. Look and feel is, means through the application there should be some kind of consistency. Suppose on the home page there is some heading. I'm using some attributes for that heading, like say font size, font color, font type. Through the application, such kind of heading should have the same attributes, should have the same property. So as to maintain consistency along my application. So as to maintain consistency means, throughout the application, all the pages should look alike to maintain my consistency. Suppose here on the Gmail, this is a link, can't access your account. It is blue in color, when I put my cursor on it, it's underlining that. Means throughout the application, I should give same attributes to all the links. See here, learn more, same attributes, create an account link, same attributes. Switch to Gmail, same, new features, same, about you, same. Every link in the website needs to have the same attribute. That is to maintain consistency along the application. Here, how I will get to know that whether my website is having good look and feel or not, is maintaining consistency or not. For this, we have WCC standard. Here, we have WCC standard. WCC standards are nothing but World Wide Web Consortium standards. WCC has given us few standards to check whether our application is maintaining consistency or not. Is having good look and feel or not. Okay, quick interface. Quick interface is, suppose, whenever you install any application, generally it creates a shortcut for you, a desktop shortcut for you. That is for the quick launch of that application. Another thing is, you can launch that application after installing through this. You can go to start, all programs, or if the application is simply here, you can click and you can launch your application. Very quick interface we are providing to open our application quickly or instantly we can open. Suppose, let's talk about if there is a website. In the website, we have seen the most viewed menus like home page, about us, contact us, sitemap, generally are placed at the top on every page. Why this? Why this? The reason is that suppose I am on the 100th page of the website. Suppose I am on the 100th page of the website, then what will happen? And I want to visit my home page. I am clicking back button 100 times. Do you think it is justified clicking the back button 100 times? The answer would be no. Nobody wants to click back button 100 times or forward button 100 times. Everybody wants instant access. Everybody wants quick access. So for that, we have home link at the top. Whenever we click here, we can directly visit our home page in a second we can visit. Similarly, there is a sitemap. We can click there. Whichever page we want to view, we can simply click and we can visit that. Because everybody is busy these days, nobody has enough time to click back button 100 times. Everybody wants instant access. That is quick interface. Whatever we want in our application, we should be able to get that instantly. That's what we want from quick interface. Similarly, desktop shortcut we get, or we can launch our application from the quick launch. Quick launch in the sense, we can go to start all programs and we can directly launch our application. Which one is better? To open up your application from desktop or from quick launch, which one is better? Well, I would say to launch your application from quick launch is better. Why so? Because suppose there are 100 windows already opened in your desktop and if you want to open your application from the desktop, then you have to minimize 100 windows. For that, instead of minimizing the 100 windows, you can simply go here to the start all programs and directly open up your application. That is a quick interface. We don't have to waste much time doing the various things. Simply we can assess our information very quickly. This was all about user interface testing. That is one of the type of the usability testing. Now we are going to talk about manual support testing. That is another type of user interface testing. Manual support testing. Name itself is telling me that every software help should be provided. With every release, that help document should be updated. Let me elaborate this point. Whenever you purchase a new television, you purchase a new mobile phone, generally you get a manual along with it. What is that? That is how you are going to install your software, what are the various features available, how you can use those various features, the helps are provided. Simply in QTP. In QTP, whenever you place your cursor anywhere and you press the function key F1, you get a help menu. In this notepad, this help menu at the top is provided. With everything, help should be provided. I told you in the previous session that there are two releases. One is internal release, second is external release. We have already discussed about this. Internal release is whenever developers develop something, they give it to the testing team for testing. That is internal release, that is within the organization. Second is external release. External is whenever you develop something, you give it to the client. That is known as external release, that is outside the organization, external release. So manual support testing, whenever there is internal release, you developers develop something and they give it to the tester, they update some previous code or they make some enhancements, they implement new features, then all those things should be updated in the help document as well. Means release by release, the help document should also be updated. And in the end, you need to provide this help document to the client as well as the other users of the application. That is help document. With every release, help document is to be updated. It also has to be enhanced. Every feature of the application should be there in the help document. That is a manual support testing. Whether we are providing relevant help to the users of the application or not. That is manual support testing. Okay. In the next video, we are going to talk about functionality testing, security testing and performance testing in detail. Functionality testing, which is further divided into 10 types of testing. We are going to talk about each and every subtype in very detail, along with lot of examples to show you, lot of real-time scenarios to show you. Okay, alright team, my battery is running out. It's giving me few percentage left, so I'm ending up the session now. We'll meet up in the next video where we will be covering these three remaining types of testing in detail. Okay then. Okay, I'm ending up the session.